Hello and welcome to Newsclick. Today we have with us Sudha Bharadwaj, who is the National Secretary of the People's Union for Civil Liberties, as well as a visiting professor at National Law University. For the past many years, Sudha has been working in the state of Chhattisgarh for the rights of workers, Adivasis and other marginalized sections of society. But recently, Arnab Goswami on his show on Republic TV claimed that Sudha is an urban Naxal. And he got evidence of this fact on the basis of contents of a letter. So, Sudha, the first question is, what is your response to these allegations?
I have immediately issued a statement. Needless to say, I have absolutely nothing to do with that letter. And it is a totally fabricated and actually defamatory and dangerous letter. Because it has been, the effort is to try to show that I'm, in contact with some Maoist leader and I'm asking for funds and have some connection with Kashmiri separatists. And it's also named a lot of other lawyers who, some of them are, very excellent human rights lawyers, some of them I don't know at all. So everybody is going to be painted with that stigma. And I have immediately refuted it. And, I still, after all those days, after it was telecast on the 4th of July. Today is the 13th. And so far, no security agency has, contacted me regarding this letter or where did that letter surface? What is its source? How has it come about? And why was it, bandied about in that manner with my photograph and, all of which are available on YouTube, mostly photographs, images from my public lectures, etc. So I was totally shocked by it. And I've also issued a legal notice to the Republic TV and the people in charge.
So this has come recently after five people were arrested again on similar charges, Mahesh Roth, Shoma Sen, all of these people, and they were also arrested on the basis of the contents of a letter. Again, there was a letter also which was discovered after their arrest. So why do you think you are also being clubbed along with these people? What is it about your work which has put you under this category?
You see, for one of the persons who was arrested was Surendra Gadling. He's a Dalit lawyer with about 30 years of experience in Nagpur. He's a very popular lawyer there. In fact, after Surendra Gadling's arrest, there was a lot of protests, a lot of demonstrations by the Nagpur District Bar, and they even passed a resolution against his arrest. So he's a very popular person, and he has been taking up very difficult cases, whether of Adivasi under trials, whether of Dalits, even in the Kherlanji and Ramabai, eviction cases and all those. So, and he and I belong to an Indian Association of People's Lawyers. He is the General Secretary and I am a Vice President. So, in fact, immediately after the arrest, I held a press conference in Press Club of India in New Delhi. And a number of lawyers also who were very, concerned with this attack on lawyers, also addressed the press conference along with me. So that could be an immediate cause of maybe irritation or nuisance which I have caused. The other thing which I am a little more concerned about is that the IAPL had actually carried out a fact-finding in the month of May into the situation of lawyers in Kashmir. They had been invited by Kashmiri lawyers because Kashmiri lawyers are facing a lot of difficulty in terms of restrictions on the way they have to conduct their profession, the difficulties that they're having in taking up human rights cases. They're also, some of them are being kept in detention, etc., etc. So a whole team had gone. Unfortunately, I was not able to go with the team, but considerable data has come out about the situation of lawyers, and we were definitely planning to come out with a report. And so maybe this was also a move to delegitimize our identity, in anticipation of anything that we might have wished to say about you know, the situation in Kashmir.
And also, probably your work in Bastar and those areas has been...
Actually, I have been in PUCL since about 2006-07, and I've been a general secretary now for about 10 years of the Chhattisgarh unit. So I have been taking up many cases. The PUCL has been taking up many cases, and we've been doing it as a civil liberties organization. We've been going to the NHRC, we've been going to the courts, to the High Court. Fake encounter cases, sexual violence cases, etc. In fact, recently the NHRC had asked for my help in investigating into a case of killing of 8 people and burning down of hamlets, etc. I had actually organized the fact finding for the NHRC, and we came out and gave them the reports. So. This human rights work which we are doing is very much in the public domain. It's a different matter that definitely it must be an irritant for the Chhattisgarh government. And apart from that, I have also, in my capacity as a lawyer, been taking up many cases on land acquisition, on tribal rights, ESA, forest rights, because there's a very, very critical situation in Chhattisgarh at the moment. That could be another reason, and considering that Chhattisgarh elections are coming up, yes. And you know, defaming me would be convenient to also defame the organizations associated with me, whether it's PUCL or my own trade union, Chhattisgarh Mukti Morcha, or whether it is, you know, this broad platform of anti-displacement movement, Chhattisgarh Bachao Andolan, with which I am associated. So that could again be a reason why super exclusive attentions have been focused on me.
So can you tell us how these land acquisition cases are fueling the conflict in the state? Because
that is a very
especially
serious...
Especially with this Nagar Nar case also, and the privatization that has been proposed.
Exactly, exactly. Actually, in that respect, both in North Chhattisgarh and in South Chhattisgarh, many of the times when we talk about Chhattisgarh, we focus on Bastar. Hmm. But actually, if you see the situation in North Chhattisgarh, where there is no Naxal problem as such, you know, but there you find, for example, in the in Raigarh, in Korba, in Koria, in Sarguja, there's an enormous crisis because of mining which is going on, yes, in these areas. Raigarh is, has been, I think, mined through and through. I mean. And the environmental devastation, the, you know, I remember a collector of Raigarh had in fact Suomoto said that there are, you know, some 100 odd cases that he had Suomoto found where lands of Adivasis are being used by mining companies in very fraudulent, you know, kind of land transactions. So fraudulent land transactions, and then of course a mining which is absolutely environmentally devastating, this has become very common in those areas. In Jashpur, for example, the elephants who have been driven out from the mining areas are now beginning to attack people. So now there's, you know, this elephant man conflict as well, that is also happening. Particularly, you know, one area, Hansdev Aran, which used to be called a no-go area. It was supposed to be very, very rich biodiversity. This is in North Chhattisgarh. There again, Adani mining has more or less taken over. So the situation is very serious, and people are actually tired of trying to assert their PISA rights, their forest rights, under the Forest Rights Act. Some, possibly only half of the individual claims have been settled so far. Yes. And community claims, very, very few, very, very few. And now the government is in fact even taking back the pattas, individual pattas and community forest right pattas, in favor of mining. So people are very unhappy about these things. Maybe that is the reason why also you found this Pathalgadi thing happening in many of these resource-rich states.
And if privatization happens of this project, of this Nagar Nar project, then those things would, I guess, become even more difficult.
Nagar Nar is a project in south, in the Bastar area. Yes, privatization there the expansion of the Belladila mine has been resisted. Then Raughat, which is just the project is just beginning, but already some 22 camps of BSF etc. have been set up, and villagers there are again saying that there has been hardly any compliance with PISA or with forest rights. We personally have done cases in the High Court, and which has now also come to the Supreme Court, because we have not given a interim relief, so we have come to the Supreme Court, regarding community forest rights of many, many villages which have not till now been granted, and those areas are all being earmarked for various parts of the project, of the Raughat project. So this is, going to be a huge bone of contention. And the rest of the area of Bastar, of course, much of it is under prospecting leases and mining leases, which because of the conflict, it's not possible for the government to actually mine there. But some thousands of acres, thousands of hectares of land is actually already recorded under such leases. So that's a very serious, and it, as you said, it could also be because we are taking up cases like this that we are being targeted.
And extrajudicial killings are also very common in the state. So yes. On the one hand, you have state's repression in this form, on the other, you have state officials saying that it is the work of activists like you which poses a threat to national security and integrity and all of that. So what do you feel about that?
Well, actually, I feel, and the stand that PUCL has continuously been taking, that if we want to de-escalate violence in Bastar, then the first thing that we need to do is to actually implement, the laws passed by Parliament properly, which means the PISA Act, which means the Forest Rights Act, it means giving powers to the Gram Sabha, it means listening to people when they're having objections. That would be the way in which you could also, show people that, otherwise the alienation from state is always complete in these areas. Because the feeling is that nobody is listening to them at all. And, I think it was the collector Alex Paul Menon, yes, who had been abducted, who had once made a statement, in fact he was issued a notice for it as well, that when he was being guarded, there were many young people guarding him, and he said that, why are you in this movement and so on, and they said, well, this was all during that Salwa Judung period, when, people were being forced, either you come to the camp, or we'll treat you as outlaws, and in fact that is the period when more and more people actually ran away to the forest. So this situation of polarization is something that we're trying to address, and we're trying to say that give people rights, that is the only way to restore any kind of faith in them.
So the state has mostly, the only resort it has taken is by means of repression.
Exactly.
But
exactly.
What can we do when this threat of Maoist is brought up, and that is the reason which is given for taking this path?
Well, exactly. In fact, nobody really talks about the mining and other things which really are the push behind all of this. Because till the 80s, Maoists were already there. But it was only in 2005-06 when you had Salwa Judum and you had MOUs with Tata and SR and all these mining leases and prospecting leases being given out, that you actually thought it necessary to, do something, do an operation like Salwa Judum. Which of course even today the government insists was, spontaneous and all that, but it was very clearly a state-sponsored operation. And the whole idea was, drain the water and kill the fish, which is a very typical military strategy, Scotch Earth policy or something like that. But actually the 644 villages which were evacuated, which had some 3 lakh population, it's only 50,000 of them that you managed to bring to the camps. And even if you say 1 lakh migrated, to Andhra or whatever, it still meant that 2 lakh people went into the jungles. So actually, if anything, it is this state intervention in the state repression, which has actually made people, think that that is the only way that they can save their lands and, you know, their forests and their livelihood. And that really needs to be addressed. I mean, running away from it is not going to help.
And oppressing it further is only going to make it worse.
Yes, yes. It's only going to make it worse. Now, these are, of course, unpopular opinions to hold. So, I expect that is the reason for being targeted also.
So, last question, Sudha, is what prompted you to take up this work in the first place? I think you were 18 when you gave up your US passport and you went to work in the forest of Chhattisgarh. What made you?
Yeah, well, actually, I am primarily a trade unionist. So, in 1986, I joined the trade union of Shankar Guha Niyogi. I was there in Dalli Rajhara, then the Bhilai movement started. It was a big movement of contract workers. I'm still with that movement. That is my primary organization. And basically, it is the trade union which made me a lawyer, because I had to fight so many cases. We anyway had to work for those cases. So my, you know, comrades in the union said that, you know, why don't you become a lawyer? So I actually became a lawyer at the age of 40. And then what I realized was that, you know, actually all movements have the same problem. Because they really don't have committed lawyers. They can't afford, you know, the people who need you most can afford to pay you least when it comes to lawyers. So, you have to, on the other side are all the corporate lawyers. So you have to be as competent as them, as, you know, well-versed and everything. But at the same time, there are no fees, you know, forthcoming. So basically, it's only the people who really... And the other interesting thing is that if you want to work with movements, you also have to learn and listen a lot to what people are saying. I could manage to, win a few cases in contract labor only because I was so close to the workers that even though they didn't have, you know, officially any scrap of paper as evidence for years and years of work, but that allowed me also to adduce other kinds of evidence. So basically, I'm a trade unionist, but injustice everywhere is a threat to justice everywhere, they say. And Niyogi's union particularly has been one which has also considered that, you know, well-being of all people in Chhattisgarh is something that union wants to fight for. So that is how I became a lawyer, and then we had a group of lawyers in Bilaspur who also basically support all kinds of, it's like group legal aid kind of thing. So we are trying to support all people's movements as far as we can. And during that, I also got involved in PUCL and so on and so forth. So yeah, so these are the kind of things that we do, and I will continue to do them irrespective of Mr. Goswami.
The need for such, for people like you is particularly strong right now.
Yes, and I'm sure if, you know, they sort of malign me, it is not going to stop other people from carrying on the similar kind of work, or the necessity of people to carry on this kind of work.
So thank you, Sudha, for talking to us today. Thank you for watching Newsclick.